यस
मोस्ट ऑफ द कॉन्सेप्ट फ्रॉम द स्कूल आर नॉट क्लियर.
ओके फाइन, मोस्ट ऑफ द कॉन्सेप्ट्स आर नॉट क्लियर. सी आई स्टार्टेड विथ क्वांटम नंबर्स. इट इज इन युवराज हियर. I started with quantum numbers. Okay, you will get the video lectures of quantum numbers. Okay, and after that we started periodic properties. That is chapter 3. So I will assert that you should please watch the quantum number chapter. And then the subsequent lectures of periodic properties. And in this class, maybe you will not get a few things, or maybe you will get a few things. But in the next lecture, you will get and you will grasp more.
Okay, okay. Okay.
Good evening, Yuvraj.
Good evening, sir.
Okay, fine. So where were we last? What did we learn last?
1 minute, sir.
So much of time we were learning the first. Jubaina, this is not your class. This is not your class. This is 11th standard. Thursday, our class is on Thursday, right?
No, we were on Z effective.
Z effective, okay, great. Jubaina, I guess you are in wrong class. Please leave. I would say this is 11th standard.
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir.
Yes, we were on Z effective.
Yes,
sir. Z effective. So there are a few points that I wrote about Z effective. What were they? You have that in your notes, right?
The size of atom, nuclear charge, yes. The screening effect, yes, of inner shell, and the screening effect, yes, of subshell.
Yes. Now, the next thing that we will learn is the atomic radius. Is the atomic radius. By atomic radius, what is atomic radius? First of all, let me make quite a vague figure of an atom. This is somewhat we can call an atom. This is this dark black portion is the nucleus. We can imagine our electrons in a wave fashion. They are in this kind of arrangement, correct? But the thing about electron is that we have understood that electron is not a particle. It is of wave nature and it is kind of a cloud, electron cloud. For example, if we take the s orbital, if you remember the quantum number class, Yuvraj, I have shown that quantum number is not perfectly spherical, rather it is something like this, correct? It has more density in the near the nucleus, and the density slowly it decreases, right? And we saw the graph of the probability of finding an electron and the radius. We saw that in the nucleus there is no electron, there is nucleus. So when r is equal to 0, it is nothing. But as soon as we go, then we increase the probability, then it decreases like this, correct? So what we get from here that it is electron cloud. And if electron is not situated in some kind of fixed boundary, then it is pretty difficult to find the radius. Because if we want to find a radius of a sphere, first of all, we need to have a sphere, but we have a spherical cloud kind of thing, right? Any doubts still here?
No, sir.
Okay, fine. So what did chemists do? They came up with an idea that, okay, fine. We don't know the radius of the sphere. But also it is very evident that hydrogen doesn't exist as hydrogen. Hydrogen exists as H2. So most of the compound, for example, if you want to take sodium, then sodium is a metal. Na is in solid form. This is in gaseous form. So most of the elements in the periodic table, except the noble gases, they exist in a compound form or they have a molecule, right? So what they said that I have got a hydrogen. Okay, fine. So let me represent this hydrogen as this. This is the nucleus. And the other hydrogen must be sharing some kind of electrons and the nucleus would be here. Okay. I think I should increase the size of these two. And erase this edge. Okay. Fine. Now, what they did, they said, okay, fine. The nucleus is here. Another nucleus is here. We will take this interatomic distance. And if this is A, then we will say A by 2 will be the radius of hydrogen. This is one hydrogen. This is another hydrogen. Okay. What they did? They did, took the combination of two atoms and they measured the distance between the nucleus and they halved it. In a sense, this is an average, correct? This is an average. So this is the trick they use to calculate the radius of covalent atoms, right? Now, what about metallic metals? For metals, that what they did, they took metallic radius. I have Na here. This is Na. This will be the nucleus. This is the rough sphere of atom and the electron cloud. Another would be here. Another would be here. I mean, they will be overlapping, but not very much. Na, Na. These are the nucleuses. So they took this, and this is the metallic ray. This is, let us take this as A. A, and then again, A by 2 is equal to metallic radius. Okay, this is the metallic radius. And this is the, if we have a covalent atom, then we get the covalent radius. If we have metal, then we get the metallic radius. Okay, now what we need to do is we need to understand the trend of these metallic bonds or the atomic bonds. Okay, so I am, do you want to copy some things? You must copy some things. This will be covalent radius. And if I select this Na and move it, here, this is Na solid. This is metallic radius. Please note this down.
So,
and if you want to understand the concept, then you can note this down. Yes.
So the combination of two metals is an imaginary concept, right? Because how do you expect two Na atoms being too close?
Sorry? How do you expect?
Two metals, metal atoms being so close.
You have iron, right?
Yes.
Fe. Have you seen iron?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Is it a metal? It is a metal.
Yes, sir.
It is a metal. So, is there anything else other than iron? Any other element other than iron in iron?
Yes, sir. Got it, sir.
Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Done noting down.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
So where do we use this atomic radius?
We will use this atomic radius when we want to find the ionization energy. If you want to remove something from a shell or an atom, then you must know how far it is from the nucleus so that we can estimate the attraction from the nucleus of that particular electron that we want to remove. If it is nearer to the nucleus, we cannot remove it very easily. If it is very away from the nucleus, we can remove that electron very easily.
Yes, sir.
See, most of the time, I would ask you, you will not have to remember numbers, but you have to have a qualitative estimation between two particular elements. If you have been given two particular elements, then you must know, okay, fine, it is in the periodic table, where it is in the periodic table, and then you will be able to estimate once we just finish this topic of atomic radius. And for this atomic radius, we will use the concept of Z effective, because what we need is the how much far the electron is from the nucleus and what is holding the electron from going far away. It is the nucleus, and it is nucleus is holding those electrons by the virtue of Z effective, that is effective nuclear charge. So we'll use the concept of effective nuclear charge to determine and to estimate the atomic radius of different elements. The same concept. Done noting down?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. I'm moving to the next slide. Now here we will look at the trends of our atomic radius. First of all, we will see from Harshit, periodic table is divided into periods and groups, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So periods are vertical or horizontal?
Periods are horizontal.
Okay, fine. So from left to right, in a period, all this talk is about good old atomic radius. You must have studied this atomic size kind of thing in the 10th standard also, I guess.
Yes, sir.
So if you go from left to right in a period, what is happening? We have a nucleus here. It has some positive charges. Don't take this as one positive charge. It can have multiple positive charge. In a period, Yuvraj, what changes? Does the principal quantum number changes as we start filling the electrons? Or the azimuthal quantum number changes? I mean to ask, do the shell change if we add electrons in the period? Yes, in a period. Or we add electrons in the subshell.
So the azimuthal quantum number changes.
Yes, the azimuthal quantum number changes. So if I start from a period and let me make only one shell, okay?
Yes.
So if I have one shell and just assume this is the valence shell. Okay, this is the valence shell.
Valence shell.
This is valence. Now we know that the electrons will be filled up in the valence shell. So as we move left from left to right, one electron is being added to the valence shell. And we know that the shell size will remain almost constant, but what will differ? Shell number. The number of electron will be different, but the other thing that will be different is if we add electron in the same shell.
So the subshells will vary.
Subshell. The subshell may change.
Yes, sir.
The subshell may change. Fine. So when we are, for example, from group one, I am starting. The most left, the leftmost corner of the periodic table. So if we start filling the electrons, we start filling in the S subshell. Yes?
Yes, sir.
Order of filling of electrons. S subshell. Then two is P. B and 4 is F. We go down in this order, fine. But the other thing that is also changing, if you go from left to right, is that increase in proton number. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Now I will take two cases and you will answer me. This has plus 3 charge and this has 3 electrons. Let me take another. These don't go by the size. This is plus 4 and this is 4 electron. Which of them, this is case A and this is case B. Now you tell me, which of these sphere, I'm assuming this is a sphere, which of them would have a larger radius?
Sir, the one with 3 electrons.
3 electrons.
Why? And Harshit, what is your answer?
Yeah, actually, I don't have my answer. It's just that as the size while going from left to right to period increases, that is electron also increases, the same conditions can be applied here and be seen.
No, I'm asking A or B, which will be having a larger size.
So A.
Okay, fine.
I have a
reason. A will be having larger. Yes, tell me the reason.
It can be that the four in the B atom, which has 4 electrons, it has much repulsion.
Sir, actually, the first one has only 3 protons, so it will have less resulting nuclear force of the atom.
Even if we assume both of these Z effectives are same, even if you assume that, then the only thing is that you have plus 3 charges here and you have minus 3 charges in the electrons, right? Now, yes. What you have to compare, is the attractive forces. You have plus 3 and minus 3. The attraction between plus 3 and minus 3 will be significantly lesser than plus 4 and minus 4. And if the attractive forces of plus 4 and minus 4 is greater, why it is greater? Because the magnitude of charge is increasing. And as the magnitude of charge increases, the attraction increases. And if the attraction increases, the size shrinks. Both of you were correct. The size of A will be greater. But the reason, what is the reason? The first principle of atomic radius is that how strongly do the nucleus attract the electrons? And most importantly, the valence shell electrons, because that will determine our atomic radius, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So just compare the attractive forces. So that means if we go from left to right in a period and we are increasing the proton number, but we are not increasing the shell size. Right. In the same shell we are not increasing the distance of the new additional electrons. That means from left to right in a period. Now let me erase these things.
So 1 minute, sir.
The only thing now, yes, though you don't have to write that. Just thing that you have to remember is from left to right in a period, the atomic size or radius we are talking about, the radius decreases. Decreases due to increase in protons, due to increase in protons and the attractive forces. So these two are important. The shell number is constant and the increase in proton number. These two are important points when we are going from left to right in a period. Please note this down and we will go to the next slide, that is from top to bottom in a group. Harshad, what is your school's name?
Sir, G.D. Birla Memorial School.
जीडी गोइंका आई गेस नोएडा
नो जीडी बिरला सर रानीखेत उत्तराखंड
जीडी ओके जीडी बिरला ओके उत्तराखंड
So what do we have to write? The atomic radius decreases, therefore due to increase in protons and attractive forces.
No, sorry. The due to was, I was writing because the opposite sign of, no, sorry, remove this. Thank you for pointing that.
Due to increase in protons and the attractive forces.
And attractive forces.
So what effect does come after attractive forces and increase in protons? The decreasing of atomic radius.
Sorry, no. What?
So
I couldn't hear you.
So atomic radius decreases due to increase in protons and attractive forces.
Yes, I mean if you what happens when attraction occurs? Things come close, right? And if they come close, the distance decreases.
No, sir. What happens when the protons increase and the attractive forces increase?
The electrons come nearer. Right, that will only happen because we have two entities, the protons and the electrons. And if the attractive forces between the protons and the electrons are increasing, that means the electrons are coming closer to the proton. And if they're coming closer to the proton, that means the size of the atom is decreasing and hence atomic radius is also decreasing. Did you get it? I think yeah. This is pretty straightforward. Okay, fine. Can I move to the next slide?
Yes, sir.
Yuvraj?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, the next thing is second. From top to bottom, in a group. The answer will be the atomic radius. What happens if we go from top to bottom in a group? What happens is we increase the shell number. We increase the principal quantum number. That means we are adding a shell. If we are adding a shell, we are increasing the size. Sorry, we are increasing the size of the atom itself. So if we are in the first, if this is a group, if we are here, for example, then it will have one shell. If we are here, then it will have one and two shell. I'm just taking this as an example. So if the shell number is increasing, then consequently, this was the distance between the nucleus and the valence electron shell. And now this is the distance. So the distance is already increasing. The atomic radius increases due to the increase in principal quantum number, denoted as n, as we add on subsequent shells.
Done, sir.
Okay, great. Now the next item in our inventory is the ionic radius. How do we write ionic radius? ionic radius.
So this has,
first of all, what is ion? What is ion?
So this has to be given a new heading.
Can you please repeat that?
So this has to be given a new heading, or we have
yes,
to
it's new heading. The previous one was atomic. New heading. This has to be a new heading because previous was one atomic radius. In that, we were dealing just with neutral elements and neutral atoms. In this, we will have we will be having charges. Okay.
Okay,
sir. So, first of all, ionic radius. What is an ion? Take the example in a solid. I mean, if we remove an electron, if we give it energy and remove an electron, it will become Na positive plus an electron. Now this is an ion. Okay. So first of all, we will learn about the ionic radius. So what is your idea? Now tell me. What is your idea?
Sir, ionic
radius. How will the ionic radius be?
Sir, ionic radius is the radius of an atom which has given electrons to form an ion. So it will have
I'm asking. Tell me the periodic trend. Tell me the trend from, for example, from left to right in a from left to right in a group.
So period.
Sorry. From left to right in a period. Apply the concept of Z effective. Okay. And tell me with some confidence, I would say.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
So as per Z effective, it also depends on the nuclear charge. So number of protons remain the same. So will there be any difference in the order?
Any difference in the
order? Like, I believe it to be the same as normal atomic radius.
What about you, Harshit?
Sir, I think that it will, the size will decrease.
Size will decrease. You mean as earlier?
Yeah.
As earlier. Okay, fine. What about if we ask about from? Top to bottom.
1 minute, sir. So the size may increase because when we are losing electrons, the repulsion forces become less as we move towards right. So size of atoms will increase subsequently. Like, this is just an assertion.
And for top to bottom, it will decrease, but with more magnitude.
You are saying it will decrease, but with
more magnitude. Period. Like the this graph will be more steep for the group and for with respect to period.
That will be the case for the previous one also. We are in that the size is increasing. You just have to remember it is nothing same as. This will be same as atomic radius. The trend will be same as atomic radius, both of them. Okay. I mean, the first concept that you applied of Z-effective, the Z-effective remains the same, right? So we just have to see the Z-effective and the electrons. Then we will decide there is nothing about repulsion, okay? Because if something is holding it down, the electronic repulsion doesn't matter here because it is very less if we compare to the attractive forces now. Okay, because the attractive forces here are very much, they overtake the repulsive forces. So we don't even mention the repulsive forces. So Z effective and the electron decreases, but Z effective remains same. That means the capacity of strongly holding remains same. That is why it will be same as atomic radius. But the important point to note is that for cations. I mean, both of this was for cations, same as atomic radius, for cations. right? For cations, the size of atomic radius is greater than the size of parent atom. Okay. But for anions, it is just opposite. For anions, because if we are adding another electron, we are adding another electron, and our nucleus had just the potential of n, and now it has n plus one electrons. We added one electron, so it cannot hold the extra electron that came just now very strongly. So for anions, the size of atomic radius is usually the size of ionic radius is usually greater than the size of parent atom. Wait a second, I messed up the statement. The for cations is greater than the size of parent atom. This will be less than.
Yes, sir.
For cations, what should I write here? Ionic radius is less than this, than that of parent atoms, and the same the opposite for cations. Now for anions,
sir.
Yes.
Sir, हम compare किया. What are we comparing actually? For cations, the ionic radius is less than that.
Parent atom. No. What is the parent atom of Na plus?
Na. So then, I'm saying that what are we comparing actually? The ionic radius with the atomic radius, or just the sizes?
We are comparing both of them. If we are going from left to right in ionic radius, the trend will be the same as atomic radius. We say just increasing and decreasing for cations, right? And for anions, and mostly anions are the non-metals, and they are very less. And also for sodium Na, it will never make an anion. We cannot add because it will be very high, and nobody will ask you about the anion Na negative. But Cl positive, we have this. If we make an FCl bond, that you will make in the next chapter. So cations are there for each and every element. We can remove, but it is not possible to add electrons in each one. Okay, for anions, the anion radius is more than that of. And also, Ajit, your voice is breaking. It would be better if you type down the question in chat.
Okay, sir.
There's a lag in your voice. Note this down. Done.
Yes, sir.
1 minute, sir.
Both of you? Okay, fine. Okay, fine. I mean, it would be better, Yuvraj, if you speak. Your voice is not lagging. And also, if Harshit's voice wasn't lagging, I would have preferred a voice over chat always. Now, to the next topic. That is ionization enthalpy. It is the energy required to remove an electron from the outermost shell. And if I see ionization enthalpy for now, it will always mean in this class as first ionization enthalpy. Ionization enthalpy. And we write it as delta I script and H for enthalpy. This is ionization enthalpy. And what does first ionization enthalpy mean? Take our good old sodium, Na, and then we removed an electron and we got Na positive plus electron. Okay. Now tell me, if we remove an electron from sodium, would we have to give energy to the system, or that the process will give out energy? The question is, will it be endothermic or exothermic?
We'll have to provide energy.
And Yuvraj, what do you think? No idea? Okay, fine. And if you are speaking, Yuvraj, you are on mute. You are not speaking. For sodium, rightly said by Harshit, that we will have to give in energy. The concept that you have to remember, please, I would focus on first principles. You have to always think with the four first principles. That is, in chemistry, you have to, these things, please remember always this. We have done this in quantum numbers, but for Harshit, symmetry leads to stability. Okay. Then second is attraction is stability. Stability. Third point, repulsion is instability. And the fourth point, stability. If something is going to be stable, if we are increasing the stability, then we are releasing energy. And if we are making a system unstable, then we are decreasing, we have to provide energy to that particular system. So as we can see here, we have a sodium atom, which is completely neutral, and we have an Na plus atom, which has a charge, and charges, they bring instability. Okay. So we have to give in some energy, and I will denote this as delta, which is heat, not completely correct, but we can also do this by heat, ionization enthalpy. Now, what will be the trend of ionization enthalpy? Remember, always remember, if we want to remove an electron from the outermost shell, that is what we are doing here. What is the ionization enthalpy? The energy required to remove an electron. Remove an electron from the valence shell of an atom. Now, it depends on delta I, that's ionization enthalpy, depends on the first thing that it's depend on is the shell number. The second, that is shell number, and the second is, if you want to write a more generalized form, I will write the shell number later on, but first of all, we will write the Z effective. What does Z effective mean? It is the attraction between, you have to look at attraction between
electron
nucleus and yes, electrons and the nucleus, correct. And the second thing that is we have to look is the electronic repulsion. Electronic repulsion within subshell. Within subshell. These are the two things that you have to. And as if I said Z effective, then automatically the shell number comes in Z effective only. Okay. Now, Yuvraj, are you there? You have to tell me the trend. Okay, fine. Chat. If you are able to speak, then Yuvraj, please speak. I don't like this kind of silence. Okay, fine. From?
Sir, am I audible now?
You are audible. Harshit's voice was lagging. You are audible from left to right.
No, sir, I was trying to unmute, but it wasn't happening.
Okay, okay, fine. Okay, it's okay. From left to right in a period. The ionization energy will increase or decrease? Harshad and Yuvraj.
It will increase.
In period or group?
Period.
In a period, it will increase. And Harsh, Yuvraj, you tell me about the group.
Sir, in a group, it will decrease.
In a group, it will?
Decrease.
Exactly correct. I mean, this is the same concept as we are as we have seen in the Z effective also, in the atomic size also, right? Sir, the atomic size increases.
Sorry to interrupt, sir, but if it's not a problem, can we move to the previous page for 1 minute?
Okay, sure. Wait a second. Just let me write this. From top to bottom in a group, the ionization energy, this will decrease. We have to provide less and less energy. Now for in a period, the ionization energy will increase. It will increase because the atomic size is decreasing. There are some anomaly. We'll look at some of the anomalies. But as for Yuvraj, yes, this. And if you're noting this, these first principles of chemistry, then note one more point. Charge means if there is charge, it is unstable.
Done.
Wait a second. If you have written charge, then the better word would be density. I would write charge density. It will accommodate the volume aspect and also the diffusement of charge. Okay, fine. From left to right in a period, delta I increases. But there are some anomalies. What are the anomalies? The first anomaly is if you look at the ionization enthalpy of beryllium, it is 899 kilojoule per mole, right? And if we look at boron, it is 801 kilojoule per mole. Now, beryllium, boron. Beryllium is how much? What is the atomic number of beryllium and boron?
4 and 5 respectively.
Yes, 4 and 5 respectively. 4 and 5 respectively. Now, why is that the case? That is the case. Now we have to look inside the shell. Inside the shell, we get the subshell. So I will write this as 1s2. This as 2s2. I will write this as 1s2, 2s2 and 2p1. Now, in beryllium, we have to remove an electron from S subshell. And in boron, we have to remove from P subshell. Now, Yuvraj, you will tell me which of them is more diffused, S subshell or P subshell?
So P subshell.
Because we don't need, P subshell. We are not looking at the shell number because the shell number is the same. That is 2. We are now looking at the subshell. If the P subshell is more diffused, that means the electrons in the P are further away from the nucleus than that of Be beryllium that is in the S subshell. Correct?
Yes, sir.
So it will be easier to remove an electron from the P subshell. So the reason for this anomaly is the P subshell is more diffused. Yes.
So this means that we'll find anomalies after every 3-4 elements, because for example, if we take the condition of 2p3 and 2p4, it is difficult to remove an electron from 2p3. So I mean, that would be alternative. So
you would see this pattern or the slight decrease in the ionization enthalpy in whole of the periodic table, almost whole of the periodic table. Okay. See, from hydrogen, helium, then it is lithium, beryllium, and boron, a slight decrease. Fine. What comes after boron?
Carbon.
Yes. Carbon is just in the group. Then there is another anomaly between oxygen and nitrogen also. We will look at that also. But first of all, let me clear this. P subshell is more diffuse. That is, S subshell is closer to the nucleus. That is, S is closer to nucleus. P subshell is more diffused. Hence, Yuvraj, can you explain him what does diffuse mean?
Sir, diffuse basically means the spread of electrons. So
see, you need to use the whiteboard, right? We explained this term just yesterday. This is situation A. Harshit, this is for you. And this is situation B. Which of them is more diffused?
A,
right? So if A is more diffused, and if we want to mark the center of both of these figures, we can mark it. Math has advanced so much. So I am just marking the center with the white in B, like just assume this white point here, na, in the black, it is the center. Now I will mark the midpoint of A. This is A. So just let us assume this is the diffused state and this is the not diffused state. So which one of them is more closer to the nucleus? The A structure or the B structure?
B.
B, right? So that is the case for S and P. And that is the case also if we go from S to P to D and then to F. S has one lobe, P has two lobes, D has four lobes, F has multiple lobes. That the structure is not in your syllabus, that is complicated. So as we go from S to P to D to F, the subshell gets more and more diffused. And as they are getting more and more diffused, they are getting away from the nucleus as well. Any doubt, Harshit?
Clear, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Have you noted this down?
Yes, sir.
Yuvraj, done noting?
1 minute, sir.
Yes, please.
Done, sir.
Okay, fine. The another anomaly is oxygen. Oxygen. Now you will tell me which one of them will have greater ionization enthalpy. Oxygen is 8. And nitrogen, how much is nitrogen?
7.
7. The electronic configuration will be helium, 2s2 and 2p4. Correct?
Yes, sir.
And for nitrogen, it will be helium, 2s2, 2p3. Now tell me, which one of them will have more ionization enthalpy?
Nitrogen.
Nitrogen will have, and why?
Because this is half stable. No, sorry, half filled electron. Half filled electron.
And so they are half filled. So.
Yeah, we have six. We have three. So they are more electron exchanges and symmetrical.
Yes, they are more. The previous concept that we looked at here, symmetry leads to stability. Yes. Sir, you are acquainted with the quantum numbers, I guess, right? And for oxygen, we have 1, 2, according to Hund's rule, and 4. For nitrogen, we have 1, 2, and 3. This is half filled. And we have the half filled. We know that this is extra stable. The half filled and the fully filled orbitals and subshells are extra stable. Hence, it will be easier to remove an electron from the oxygen. And the next thing here, it is extra stable. And this has electron repulsion in paired electrons.
Excuse me, sir.
One of these, yes, please.
So if we like analyze it this way, then an atom with atomic configuration of 2s2, 2p6, and no, so then it will be 3s2, 3p6, and what am I saying, sir? Sorry. 4s square, 4p4, 4p6, okay. And 3d, suppose 3d5, and an atom of 3d6. So they will experience the same kind of...
First of all, yes, you are going in the right direction, but you also have to look at the sizes of the subshells. As we increase the size of shell, we have seen, right, the 1s orbital. The 1s orbital is this shape, the 2s. This is the same s, but it is larger in size, and this is the size, right?
Yes.
We have looked at it. So if the size of the subshell is increasing, that means the electronic repulsion will be decreasing because they are now having more volume to spread over. And as I said, the charge density is that which matters, not the magnitude of charge. The charge density leads to instability. Now, if we are decreasing the density of charge as we are increasing the volume, what is density? Density is, for charge density, we will have Q, that is charge, and then we will have volume. We're increasing the volume, then we are decreasing the density. So the electronic repulsion will not be so much significant if we move from top to bottom in a group. Any doubt?
No, sir.
You understood, na? Like why the electronic repulsion will decrease? Because we are increasing the shell sizes. And as we increase the shell size, the subshell size increases. As we increase the subshell size, the volume increases, and subsequently the density decreases, and hence the electronic repulsion will be less. Okay, this is the train of thought that you should have. Fine. So now let me write the statement. The statement is electronic repulsion. Nitrogen will have, I will not write so much, I will just write this. Delta I H of nitrogen is greater than delta I H of oxygen. So if this is this question comes in CBSE, write these two points. Okay, this is the first point. You will write the ionization enthalpy of nitrogen is greater than ionization enthalpy of oxygen because electronic repulsion in paired electron exists in oxygen. And nitrogen is half filled, and in brackets, it is extra stable. This is the second point. These are the two points that leads to this kind of anomaly. Okay. Now I'm asking you a question. I'm giving you a question. predict the, this is a beautiful question in NCERT, predict the delta IH, that is the ionization enthalpy of aluminium. Aluminium, predict the delta will be closer to 575, this is kilojoule per mole, or 760 kilojoule per mole from the following data. What is the data? They have given some of the ionization enthalpy of different atoms. They have given that of sodium, magnesium, and silicon. For sodium, it is almost 496. All these are in kilojoule per mole. Okay, this is 737, and this will be 786. All of them are in kilojoule per mole. Please try this out. Okay, I've got an answer. Both of you, 760. Okay, fine. So here I would say NCERT tricked you. The real question was here, it was what they did is they gave you the abundance, the choice of abundance, right? You have to choose between this abundant data. They gave you so much information, but all this was not worthwhile. What you have to look, the real question was, what was the real question? The real question was, is the, now first of all, tell me, in this data, these three datas, which data is between these two values, between 575 and 760, which of them?
Sodium and magnesium.
Sodium is away from sodium is less than 590. Magnesium, right? So between only magnesium. So the real question was: is the delta IH of aluminium greater or less than Mg? Right. You don't have to print. See, they have given this data, but you always know in chemistry, we don't need data. We just need some. Okay, fine. You want to ask me about aluminium. Give me something regarding sodium and magnesium. I will tell you around how much it is. Right. So the real question is the delta IH of aluminium greater or less than magnesium? So to calculate that and to see that and to compare that, what we have to do, we have to go to our good old electronic configuration. And if you write the electronic configuration of Mg, which is 12, what we will get? We will get, first of all, neon, that is 10. Then what we will write? 3s2. Then we have aluminium, which is 13. For that, we will write neon, 3s2 and 3p1. Now tell me, which of them will have greater ionization enthalpy?
Magnesium.
So magnesium.
Right? Greater enthalpy. That means delta IH of aluminium is less than delta IH of Mg. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Now, just go back and look at the data. It is 737. Which of these values is less than 737.
Sir,
575, right?
Yes, sir.
No. Between these two values, you have to compare the 575 and 760. Which of them is less than 737? 575, correct?
Yes, sir.
575, yes. So, so we will write delta IH of AL will be near 575 kilojoule per mole. And you will write the reason that you have this S subshell, right? And we know the shielding of S subshell is great, is very large. And it, this S subshell is shielding this P subshell. So if it is shielding the P subshell, that means the P subshell is not getting enough of the nuclear charge. So the reason that you will write here is the 3S2 subshell is shielding the 3P electrons. You want the previous slide or just this slide? This slide, I guess.
So even the previous slide.
You also want the previous slide? Okay, fine. I missed one slide. I added two slides.
Yes, done.
Done?
Yes, sir.
Harshit, done?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So these are the anomalies, and this is the concept of ionization enthalpy. And we have now the these are the trends, right? We saw the anomalies. Now let's go to the next term, that is electron gain enthalpy. Electron gain enthalpy. We denote this as delta EG of H. H is for electron gain enthalpy. What is electron gain enthalpy? For example, we have chlorine atom plus an electron. This will give me chlorine negative. Now tell me, okay, fine. You know this idea, right? Wait a second. If I say we did a process and we did a chemical reaction and energy is positive, then is it exothermic or endothermic?
Exothermic.
No idea?
Exothermic.
No. If we are saying positive, that means
positive
in
means
chemistry. Yes, positive so means endothermic. If you want to remember it.
Sir, so actually, it depends on which side of the equation it is.
So you asked about the reaction.
Exactly.
Or...
No. Exactly. It depends on which side we are looking. If you are looking from your perspective, how much energy do I have now and how much energy I have given to the system, then obviously you are decreasing your energy, right? If you're giving it to the system and you're increasing the energy of system.
Yes, sir. But if it's produced, it would be
exothermic. So in chemistry, just remember, in chemistry, we see the energy of the system. Okay, so if you are providing energy, we are adding energy in the system, hence positive. And if you are adding energy, this will be endo. And if energy is negative, that means we are taking energy. That means we are decreasing energy from the system. And it is also called as exothermic. Okay.
Yes.
So now tell me, this process, chlorine, what this will be, endothermic or exothermic?
Endothermic.
Okay, both of them. Please tell me why. First, Harshit.
It's taking an electron.
Because we don't supply any energy to, for the chlorine to accept electron. it does it by
itself. I am so much asking. See these, please, first principles. What are the first principles that I said? Please think in that manner.
Stability.
Stability. Okay, fine. What are the terms that, see, unstable, that means endothermic. If it is stable, it is releasing energy, that means exothermic, right? Let me go to the first principle that I have written. Are you seeing any symmetry? Yes or no? We are not seeing any symmetry. Is there any attraction? Is there any repulsion? Fine. These are the attraction and repulsion terms are happening. Because if we are adding an electron, then the electron that we have added is now attracted by the nucleus, correct?
Yes, sir.
Right. If we add an electron, it will be attracted. The first thing is attracted by the nucleus. Fine. So this means that it is going to be stability. We are giving stability. This will mean that this process should be exothermic. But the another thing that is happening is repulsion between electrons. If you are adding an electron, that means we are also increasing the repulsion between the electrons that are already present. So that means we are making it unstable. That means this will be endothermic, right? Now both of them are happening. Now there will be a fight between these two. And the magnitude of the Z and the electrons that are repelling the incoming electrons will decide what is happening, exo or endo. So generally speaking, if we avoid hydrogen and helium, these are very small atoms. If you look at larger atoms, what happens is we have plus three electrons. Let's take example of lithium, plus three, right? It already has three electrons. Now we add one more electron. It is now plus
four.
Three. Proton doesn't change. Now it is left as four electrons. Now, these four electrons are not equal. They are 1s2, 2s2, and 2p1. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Right. So you can see that we are adding only one electron. It will be this configuration, 1s2 and 2s2, correct? So the 1s2 will not bother the incoming electron because it is not going to its orbital. I mean, if somebody comes in your street or your mahalla, you don't bother if they don't come in your home. If they are coming at your home, you have to change the situation of your home, right? And obviously, if they are not coming in your room, you will not even bother. You will not even come out of the room. You will not even peek out of the room. You will be just, okay, fine. That means the incoming electrons, the 1s2 has nothing to do with the incoming electrons. Why? Because they are not coming in their orbit. The electron that was present, I mean, if I write it here, 1s2, 2s1. Now this electron, now this will be bordered. Okay, fine. Who is coming in my room? I will repel him. I will not let him live. So see, the repulsion is caused by only minus one charge. But the attraction is from plus three charge. Now who will win? The ball is on your court, guys.
Sir, can you please repeat the last line?
Okay.
Attraction.
Okay, fine. I'm saying that the last line is the repulsion is due to this one electron. Correct?
Yes.
But the attraction is the Z effective of plus three. Correct?
Yes, sir.
That means the repulsion is with this minus one charge. And the attraction is due to plus three charge. Now, who will win? If we have a fight between plus three and minus one, who will win?
Sir, plus three.
So much. Yes, exactly. Plus three will win, right? So if plus three is winning, that means attraction wins. Attraction wins. And if attraction wins, that means generally, I'm again saying generally, delta EG H, electron gain enthalpy, is negative. Okay. please write this slide down and so, sir, grasp the idea.
So, sir, we have to do this for every atom we have to do.
No, we don't have to do this. We did this in so much details. See, we are just recognizing patterns here.
Yes, sir.
So much details for the first thing, and then we will generalize the other thing. Fine.
Yes, sir. So, sir, we mean to say usually attraction wins.
Yes, usually attraction wins, but you can see, you can compare, right? We had a very, so much nice case here, minus one and plus three. We already can say that attraction wins.
Done, sir.
Done? Harshit, done?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I guess you said yes, sir. If not, then you will.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So the first point that I not done.
I said yes, sir.
Okay, yes, sir. Okay, fine. I mean, your voice is lying. I cannot. Fine. The point that I have to write is electron gain enthalpy, that is delta EGH, increases with increase in atomic number. In atomic number. What does this mean? It increases with increase in atomic number. It means that delta EGH I am not audible. Harshit, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yuvraj, I guess there is some problem in your side. Delta EGH gets more negative as we go from left to right. Am I audible now, Yuvraj?
Yes, sir.
On delta EGH gets less negative as we go from top to bottom in a group. Now, why is this? Why it is getting less negative as we are going down the group? The answer is very easy. We are, if we just bombard an electron in this shell, an electron, and we have another case, and we bombarded an electron in this case. This is case A, this is case B. Now tell me, in both of these cases, which electron, the A electron or the B electron, will feel more of Z effective?
A,
right? Because it is closer to the nucleus, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yeah, so no need to explain further the third point, right? Now let me this. Now the next point is we have oxygen and fluorine, right? We have oxygen and fluorine. Oxygen, the delta EG of oxygen and fluorine is less negative than the subsequent one. Now, why does that happen? Let us write the statement first. The delta EG H of oxygen and fluorine is less than their subsequent elements. Subsequent elements in the group. What should happen was, if you are going from top to bottom in a top to bottom in a group, then the delta EGH, that is electron gain enthalpy, should be less and less negative. But what we see is an anomaly in oxygen and fluorine. Now, why does that happen? It happens because the reason. Reason is, look at oxygen. What is the atomic configuration of oxygen? It is 8. What should I write for 8?
1 is 2.
Tell me the electronic configuration.
1 is 2, 2 is
1 2. 1 is 2.
2 for 4.
2p, 4. And for fluorine, we have, what is the
atomic number of
fluorine? 1s2, 2s2.
5.
2p5, yes, wait a second. I'm just 2p5. Now, if you want to add an electron, you can see this 4 and this is now 5, correct? If we want to add an electron, then the whole of the 4 electrons, they will be so much worried, and all of this 5 electron, they will be worried, and they will be exerting the repulsions, correct? So this is one of the point that the existing, no need to, the electronic repulsions, I can say, right? The electronic repulsion, first thing. Now, this is thing about oxygen and fluorine. If you go down the group, the next one will have, they will have N is equal to 3, correct? And if they have N is equal to 3, then L will be equal to 0, 1, 2, these three azimuthal quantum number. This is for S subshell, this is for P subshell, and this is for D subshell, correct? Now, we can add an electron in the D subshell if you go further down, right? Right?
Yes, sir.
Also, the other thing is, if this is N3, so this will be 3P. And if we compare between 2P versus 3P, now tell me, which one of them will be larger, 2P or 3P?
3P.
Now, 3P is greater in size. If 3P is greater in size, that means 3P electrons will face less repulsion. Correct? And if they will face less repulsion,
yes, sir,
if it is less repulsion, that is, yeah, so that is the thing that you have to write. So the statement, the reason that you will write in your examination is two things that you have to remember. That is, the N for oxygen and fluorine is 2. And for the subsequent element, the N is equal to 3. Right? So the reason you have to write is, for oxygen and fluorine, electron is occupied, or is added, I should write, is added in N is equal to 2 smaller quantum level. Smaller quantum level than the subsequent elements in which N is equal to 3, 4, etc. Hence, repulsion is less in subsequent elements. I think you need the previous slide. Yes.
Done, sir, with this line.
Done? Okay. We were talking about electron gain enthalpy. So let us do a question. Electron gain enthalpy. Which of them?
Can we go one slide back?
Okay, fine. Okay, fine. Sorry. You had one more slide, right? Harshit, have you written the previous slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
Done, sir.
Done? Okay. The following elements will have the most and the least negative delta EGH. What are the elements? Elements are phosphorus. Now you have sulfur, now you have chlorine, and you have fluorine. Compare, you have to compare.
So less negative मतलब more stable ना?
Less negative means more stable. No.
More negative means more stable.
Yes.
Excuse me, sir.
In general, yes, yes, Yuvraj.
Sir, we will have sulfur. Then fluorine, chlorine, and then
phosphorus. Just tell me the least and the most. Just tell me the least and the most.
The least negative one. So the least negative one will be sulfur. Like, which is the least stable, right? Least stable, okay, will be sulfur. That.
I have asked the least negative delta electron gain enthalpy. That is, I've asked the least negative electron gain enthalpy. So what you have to do, first of all, you have to give an electron to each of them. Correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Then sulfur will have the... sir, if electron can fit in easily, then it will have more electron gain enthalpy or less electron gain enthalpy?
Fine, let us see. What did you ask, Yuvraj? I was reading the chat of Yuvraj, Harshit. Harshit said this thing. Cl, and then I guess F, then I guess phosphorus, then I guess sulfur. See. First of all, just go back to your previous notes. Electron gain enthalpy increase with increase in atomic number. Electron gain enthalpy gets more negative as we go from left to right. Okay, fine. Left to right. Then let us look at phosphorus. And if you know the periodic table, right? If you both of you know the periodic table, then you must also know that what comes below phosphorus. What comes after phosphorus? Wait a second.
Sulfur.
What comes after phosphorus? Yes.
So after phosphorus, if it's sulfur, then chlorine, then chlorine.
Sulfur, we have chlorine here, and then we have fluorine.
Yes, okay. Sir.
And the another trend that we know that is delta electron gain enthalpy gets less negative as we go from top to bottom. Top to bottom in a group. Okay, so let us go. First of all, if you are going this side, then it will increase. That means fluorine will already have higher than this previous ones?
Yes, sir.
Wait a second. You're not. Wait a second. Let me just write the these compounds. What is above phosphorus? It is nitrogen, right? And it is oxygen. Let us compare all of them now. We'll get a more clear picture. Now, if we arrange this one, NOF, then we can say that fluorine greater than oxygen and greater than nitrogen. Correct? Why?
Yes, sir.
This statement.
So-called.
This is statement. Correct? This statement. More negative as we go from left to right. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Now, if we compare these things, then we can always write chlorine. I mean, this is magnitude, okay? This is magnitude. Chlorine, sulfur, and phosphorus. Now, we have done this. This is also magnitude. Now, we have to compare between group. If we compare nitrogen and phosphorus, which will be greater? Nitrogen and phosphorus, guys, which will be greater?
Nitrogen.
Yes, nitrogen, because of this statement. As we go down, the delta electron gain enthalpy becomes less negative. So we will say nitrogen has greater than phosphorus, right? Now for oxygen and sulfur, this will be the case, correct? And for fluorine and chlorine, this will be the case because we have just seen for the oxygen, wait a second. For sulfur also, it will be like this, correct?
Yes, sir.
Now, both of you tell me, which one will be the least negative? Just see this thing, okay? I mean, is there any element which doesn't have this open end towards itself? Which is that element?
Sir, I believe chlorine will be the least negative.
No, chlorine is most negative. See,
what do you say? Nitrogen.
Not nitrogen. See. Simple
nitrogen
as that.
It was more than phosphorus.
We have. Yes.
Phosphorus.
See, for fluorine, oxygen, and nitrogen and phosphorus, we have at least two inequality signs. For fluorine, yes, we can see that it is greater than something, but it is less than something. For oxygen, we can see that it is greater than something, but it is less than some two things. Now, for phosphorus, we see that it is less than everything, correct?
Yes, sir.
Correct?
Yes, sir.
Now you have to look at the other atom, just the opposite of phosphorus, which has two inequality signs, and both of them, it has the open end of the inequality sign. That means chlorine is the most negative electron gain enthalpy, and phosphorus will have least negative electron gain enthalpy. Now you know how to approach, right? You don't, oh my God, so much of inequality signs, where I have to know. Just see, okay, fine. Oxygen is the only one and the sulfur is the only one which is having three. Leave them. Which are having two, see them. You can see that phosphorus is having no open-ended inequality signs. Chlorine is having both of the inequality sign open-ended towards itself. So that means it is most negative. That means phosphorus is least negative. Okay?
Yes, sir.
There is a saying. Yes, Harshad, please. Somebody said something. Please speak now.
No. I said yes, sir. I agree.
There is a saying. Don't work for maths. Make the math work for you. Okay. You don't have to make the, you don't have to work for maths. I mean, this inequality sign is from math. You don't have to so much hustle and stress about it. You have to make the math work for you. Always remember this, okay?
Yes.
Okay, can any one of you tell me, Harshit, what time was given to you today for today's class?
8:30 to 10.
Okay, fine. And I understand, Yuvraj, you want to leave. Okay, fine. I was asking just Harshit, do you know when is the next class?
Next class, sir, no idea.
No idea. Yes, same here. You will ask Nishkar, sir. Okay.
Sir, Nishkar, sir,
and
told
Nishkar,
me
sir,
that
will inform you.
Sir, Nishkar sir told me that he is rescheduling the classes from 7 p.m.
From 7 p.m.?
Yeah, 7 yes. to 8.
Silent, sir, like, we have a discussion about this after the class. Like, this is the same thing.
Fine. Okay, great. Okay, fine. Then have a discussion with Nishkar sir and come up with a time, okay? Come up with a time. And see, okay. I will prefer if you have 3 days and 2 hour slots. This is the most preferred thing because in 2 hours, the pace gets very, very high. And then you are also, I mean, if you don't have so much of work in your past day and in the afternoon, then it gets easy. I prefer this, but according to you guys, just discuss it with Nishkar sir. So I'm leaving this class here and please revise and thank you for your